session ends the day before. Hey, fly. What are you doing? Get your 15 minutes. Anyway. It's an early Monday morning, and I'm sitting in the car listening to the rain. A moment ago, I was listening to Jack Kornfield's book, After the Ecstasy, The Laundry. And he's talking about embodied awakening, which sounds a lot like my work. Basically, being present in your body, exploring your body in the here and now, taking advantage of your body in this moment. And I don't mean exploiting it. I simply mean using it, or better said, letting it take you for a ride. That embodied awakening is not about sitting in meditation. It's not about avoiding the body. He's telling story after story of Buddhist monk who has serious physical problems because they don't take care of their bodies because they believe in mind-body duality. Well, he doesn't, and I don't either. So he's all about celebrating the body and being in your body while you have one. So I like this. This is good. Embodied awakening. I wish more people were talking about this, especially in so-called spiritual circles. All right. Upstairs to move my body. I just caught myself at it again. As I was walking towards the door, I heard a voice in me say, "It's raining out, it's late. Why don't you just take the elevator?" I heard that, I caught it, and I got the camera out as I noticed that was taking place. And now I'm walking up the stairs backwards, because what does the rain have to do with me walking up the stairs or taking the elevator? What does the time of day have to do with walking up the stairs or taking the elevator? Clearly I'm capable. Clearly I'm not exhausted. This is fine. Even though I'm going backwards, it's quite comfortable. But why was that part of my brain creating a story about the rain and the time of day? Gotta catch these things, because it's so easy to believe them. So easy to think that what they're telling us is truth. But that's very rarely the case. I'm at the studio extra early today because I'm giving a talk to the Rotary Club. We have two in Bennington. I spoke to the first one in March, maybe? I don't know, June? I forget. Anyway, this is the other Rotary Club, and they meet here in the mill over there. And we're gonna talk about compassion and willpower, and hopefully I get a chance to film it. Yeah, having some breakthrough thoughts on willpower related to compassion. I'm kind of teasing apart the mechanics of mind, M-O-M. Anyway, here we go. I'm talking about athletics because that's the experiment that I'm currently engaged in, but with the people I work with, it's about trying, it's about curiosity. Yes, I'm angry, yes, I'm frustrated. Okay, got it, something needs to change. Now let's be curious, let's widen our lens, let's look around. What little steps can I take? What process can I engage in with curiosity that before you know it, oh my God, I just built my house. Like, I've been avoiding building this house for 10 years now, and I'm in the middle of building my house, and I put the foundation in today, and oh, I got the studs up, and oh, now I'm on the second floor. And wow, how did that happen? Because you weren't thinking about the goal. You're simply curious about the process. So this is what compassion is. Compassion is not about empathy. Compassion is not about I need to feel bad for these people. Compassion is about I'm really curious about what's going on with you and how I might facilitate you in taking the steps that you think will actually improve your life. And maybe if those steps aren't going to improve your life, maybe you can be curious with me and we can investigate, well, what steps could we take? You've got this goal and you think you need to do this, but do you really? What if there's something else you can do that would light you up even more, that would empower you even more, that would allow you to experience yourself
in a much more dynamic, systemic, empowered way. Are you interested? Are you curious about that?
I'm listening to this all day long. It's about 9:30 a.m. and I'm not feeling ready to roller ski, but I have time pressure today because I've got to help my dad get some gravel at 11. So I've got this small window of movement possibility. It's nice outside. So rather than forcing myself to roller ski, I'm simply getting dressed. I'm done now. I'm gonna walk towards the door, I'm gonna walk outside, and per usual, I'm gonna see what happens. But my conscious feeling self is not interested in roller skiing as a conceptual activity. But the getting dressed part, okay, that wasn't bad. There was nothing bad about that. The walking towards the door part, I don't fear that. The opening the car part, I can't imagine myself fearing that. So the individual components seem safe. I'm getting evidence that they're safe, but this idea of roller skiing, the idea of roller skiing just rubs me the wrong way right now. It's like, it's too early. I'm not ready, but I'm not ready to do what? We'll see if there's a point in the individualized step process that I'm not ready to take. I doubt it. But we'll see. I'm open to the possibility.
Somebody pissed on my wheel while I was upstairs. Interesting.
It is a very bright and sunny morning, and I'm spending a little bit of time in the educational bubble. Just finished Jack Kornfield's book, After the Ecstasy, The Laundry. Good book. Review going up on Patreon soon. Really nice to hear a Buddhist teacher talking about grounding Buddhism and grounding spiritual journeys, let's say. That all too many people try to become something better in their spiritual practice. And that's not what Buddhism is about, or at least that's not what the Buddha intended. And it's very much in alignment with my work. We're not trying to become better. We're just trying to ground ourselves in what is, so that what is becomes better. All right, I'm gonna head to the studio and I don't know, maybe some editing. I'm having a hard time listening to my own thoughts. Maybe work on a shelf project. We'll see.
This coming Sunday, I'm going to be roller skiing up Whiteface Mountain outside of Lake Placid, New York. This is the same mountain that they had the Olympic downhill events on in 1980, and it's where I competed in the US Mountain Running Championships last summer. And I'm scared. It's a big mountain. The race is 5 miles long, climbs over 2,200 feet or about 700 meters, and has an average grade of 8.4%. So it's just a relentless grind. So I have been practicing efficient, gentle V2 technique on all of the climbs around the Bennington area. And what I just got present to is that I'm changing as a skier. And this is exciting because what I'm changing into is a relaxed, efficient skier. When I raced in high school and college, I was a hammerhead. I would just completely devastate myself. And a lot of the racing that I've done in my comeback since 2021 has been the same. except for the World Championships in Kenmore, Alberta in 2022. The final race, when the doctor said, don't even race, just go out there and ski easy because of my heart. I skied comfortably, relaxed, efficient, and I was in a sprint finish for the podium at the end after 45 kilometers. So as a runner, I am super, super chill in the races now. I let everybody get away. I run my own pace. I try to find the most efficient means of forward motion. And I have a pretty good time. But as a skier, I have failed to find that until now. And I didn't realize it until today. And it's because I practice V2ing everything. V2 is when you have both poles going over one leg. So two poles per leg. The V1 technique is alternated poles on one leg. So one leg always gets the poling and the poles are slightly offset. So you can have a higher tempo this way, but you don't get as much power. And the V2 causes me to be more relaxed. And because it requires more power, you have to learn to be more efficient. Anyway, so as I'm training for this race, I realize I'm really scared. I'm scared of trying to V2 up an entire mountain at an 8.4% slope. That is ridiculous, especially at my age. The top athletes, the US ski team members that are going to be there on Saturday, they'll V2 the majority of it. There'll probably be some sections where they're going to go into their V1 to keep their momentum up and to reduce power output. If I can pull it off at 55 and stay relaxed and calm and efficient and comfortable, that's a gigantic breakthrough for me. So training for this race, and more specifically, training to have a relaxed V2 is changing how I ski. And I'm starting to enjoy it. And I'm starting to just be calm in the midst of a really powerful, balanced, dynamic position. So I'm excited to see what happens on Sunday. I have no idea. As long as I can stay calm and be efficient, good things could result. Austin Hill Road. I'm gonna walk down, ski up, walk down, ski up. At its steepest, it's an 18% grade. In preparation for the Whiteface climb on Sunday, I wanted to get in one more hill climb day, testing out my new gentle V2, and I picked three of the biggest hills in town, and it's pretty comfortable. Hills that were impossible for me to V2 up in the past, or when I finally could V2 them, I'd get to the top and I would be devastated. Today, they were quite comfortable. Got to the top and I was fine. So the technique, the full core engagement, the relaxation, the being more gentle, especially when I start, and also the strength. The strength training has really made a big difference, up and down, legs and upper body. So I'm excited to see what's possible at Whiteface, because I am in much better climbing shape than I ever have been. Getting ready for the Whiteface Mountain Roller Ski Race. So I got some new sharp pole tips, some fresh wheels because the ones I'm using are kind of ground down, and some new cork grips. So I am ready to rock and roll. Just finishing up a fun roller ski, testing out the new wheels and poles, and they're awesome. And I'm feeling super, super good in my technique. Can't wait for the race. Anyway, I passed two little girls on bikes and a mom as I was going down a hill, and one of the little girls screamed out, "Stop, stop, you have to watch." So I awkwardly came to a stop in about 80 feet, turned around, and the mom's like, she just took the training wheels off today. The girl's probably, I don't know, 3 or 4 years old. Anyway, the mom pushed her for about 10 feet and then she pedaled for maybe 20 feet, fell down, and like, "You have to watch again." Got back up, repeated the same thing, and I was cheering her on the whole time. And it was just so neat to see that excitement, that moment. Like, the training wheels are off. And this is me, awkward, unstable, and yet super excited. Like, she fell down both times, landing in the grass, helmet, knee pads, etc. But she wasn't afraid to crash. She wasn't afraid to try and succeed for a little bit and then ultimately fail in adult terms, and got off the bike the second time as she crashed and was just smiling. I'm like, yes, way to go. If only we could do that as adults. If only we could take our training wheels off and not be afraid of falling in front of other people. Imagine that.
I'm doing my best right now not to panic and to use my tools, because I just discovered that the registration link for Sunday's race is closed. I thought it closed tomorrow. So I was checking the weather, and then I checked to see who's entered, because we got a big storm coming up the coast and I don't want to pay for a race entry if the weather's going to be horrific on the mountain, because it's like almost 5,000 feet exposed to wind and we got a hurricane moving in. So anyway, it's closed. I don't know what to do. There's no day of registration. Tomorrow's my mom's 85th birthday, which I'm not going to miss. I could drive to Lake Placid tomorrow. They have a 2-hour window to register in person, but I'm not going to miss her birthday. And I would also have to pay for lodging tomorrow night. So that's not an option. So I'm going to email the race organizers and hopefully they can make an exception and take payment online. I'll give them all my info, but yeah, I don't want to say working hard, but I have been so focused on preparing for this race. And I'm so curious as to what I could possibly do with my new and improved V2 technique and increased strength. Well, if I can't go, I can't go. I gotta pivot. That's like everything else in my life. When I reach one of these critical points where I discover that it is not gonna happen, just gotta roll with it. So I'll email them in a minute. If they don't respond or they don't let me in, then I just pivot and they'll be the next thing. There's always the next thing. This race is gonna be in the rearview mirror so quickly anyway that the disappointment that I'm feeling right now will pass. It'll just blend into life and I won't even notice in a week or two. So that's where I'm at right now. Hoy. Always check the links to see when they close and then write it down somewhere. All right, I gotta email them. I've been distracting myself with some elliptical as I waited for a response to the email I sent out a couple hours ago, and I just got a message saying that they'll let me into the race, I can pay them the morning of, and they'll put me in the who's registered list. So, huge sigh of relief. I would have pivoted, but I also would have been a bit disappointed, and now I can see what I got. I can see what I'm made of, and I'm excited for that, but whoo, close call. I just finished packing for tomorrow's race, and now I gotta go home and celebrate my mom's 85th birthday and have a gentle, chill, relaxing evening with family. Then I'm waking up maybe at 3:30, leaving at 4 a.m. It's almost 3 hours to Whiteface Mountain. I'm really excited and nervous. I'm concerned about my heart. I'm hoping it doesn't do its thing. It's been a little extra triggery of late, but if my heart cooperates, I'm skiing really well. My form is better than it's ever been. The little tweaks I've made for more core engagement and how I'm using my arms a little bit higher and how I'm getting my legs underneath me and really diving deep into them. It just all feels so strong and smooth. The question is, how long can I maintain it? I did a 1-mile climb here in town the other day as a test, trying to ski at a pace that I think I would race at. And it was definitely, I wouldn't say comfortable, but it was doable for a mile. I didn't feel like I was done at the end. And that pace, by the way, would have me in the top five if I were to maintain it for an additional 4 miles. It's a 5 mile race. So I know I can ski well. I know I can ski fast. The question is, how long can I maintain it before I'm guessing my legs give out? I think my upper body is going to be fine, but I'm guessing that my legs will give out first. So it's a question of when and how much time do I lose if and when they do. Okay, I gotta head home. See you tomorrow.
It's a little after 3 a.m. I had to get up to go to the bathroom and looked at the clock and thought, might as well just get out of bed and leave. Race starts at 8 a.m. So if I slowly get into action and leave now, I'll get there at maybe 6:30, which is perfect. I'm 1 hour and 20 minutes into the trip, and I'm taking a stop at the Adirondack Welcome Center between Saratoga and Glens Falls. And they have the Adirondack Walk of Fame over here, kind of like the Hollywood version. And I'd never looked at it before, but I found two names on here that are of interest. Number one, we have Kevin Bacon. I didn't know Kevin Bacon was from the Adirondacks. And then way up here we have, where is she? Georgia O'Keeffe, who I know lived in Lake George and did a lot of her early paintings of Lake George before she moved to the desert. Let's see if they're open. It's not even 5 o'clock yet. And they are open, yay! That's the mountain I'm gonna be roller skiing up, Whiteface. If you don't know what the Adirondacks are, that's a map of the state of New York. And that's the Adirondack Park, which is the largest park in the United States. 6 million acres. That looks like I would say a 6 to 7% grade, and apparently it's like that the whole way. So V2able. Coming in.
That's like the most classic thing ever to me.
In second place, Logan Moore. Adrian Paul Smith, Logan Moore, SMST2.
Middlebury.
Granger, SMST2. He's a Panther. Don't mind. Congratulations. Good skiing out there. My bad. Summertime, SMST2, Middlebury Panther. And our winner today, he came back 4 years later after Chase and Kyle Bradtree, the younger man, Jack Lang. Open Women Long Course in third place, SMST2, Lauren Jordberg. Second place from Millbury College, Shay Brahms. And returning 10 years later than her last effort up the hill. Sprinter in the world currently. Beautiful. Master in 10 long course in third place from High Beach Cyclery, NYSEP, Tom Delaney. Good job, man. Second place, Francis Tichot. Put down one awesome effort. He was way up in there with the young guys. Tim Van Orden.
I don't even know what category to put that race in. It was both a humbling and incredible experience. And by the way, I just got a ride down the mountain with one of my old Middlebury teammates, Craig Jenkins, who was there watching his son, who got seventh overall. Kid is incredible, and he's got thighs like tree trunks. Anyway, had a nice chat with Craig and his son and his dad on the way down the mountain. And good to see him again. I haven't seen him since probably 1989 or 90. Brought back memories. Anyway, I was smart at the start. You have to double pole for like the first, 30 meters. And I let everybody get ahead of me because they were using up way too much energy too early in the race. And I probably dropped back into about 50th place. And then felt really comfortable, just a nice gentle V2. I couldn't go any faster than a gentle speed because there were so many people around me. I didn't want to get polled or have my own poles broken. It took me a while to get through the crowd, probably a mile or more before I was able to ski at the speed that I wanted to ski at which time the leaders were gone. They were out of sight and there were long vistas and I couldn't see them. So they were already minutes ahead of me. Within the first mile. But once I got on my own, I just kept my V2 going, kept working on form and efficiency, kept my legs underneath me as best I could, shortened my strides a little bit, increased my tempo so as not to slow down too much and lose momentum between strokes. And it really surprised me how many of the young guys were doing V1, and I was catching them so quickly. Because V1's a lot slower. And it just didn't make sense to me that these young, strong kids are not training V2 more. If I can do it at 55, after having skied now for a little over 2 years, using the newer techniques or learning the newer techniques, young people learn faster. Young people have bigger engines. They can develop strength quicker. So that was surprising to me that I was... the lone V2er. Anyway, there were two sections where I had to go into a V1 because we went around corners and we were exposed to the wind. And it was intense wind, like 20, 30 mile an hour winds once we were above tree line. So I had to go into a V1 just to be able to move. But that's it. Everything else I V2'd. So if it wasn't for the wind, I would have V2'd the entire mountain, which is exciting. My glutes were the thing that went. It wasn't my quads, which I suspected. It was my glutes. So that's what I have to work on in order to maintain a powerful V2 for long periods of time. My glutes are the weak link. And it's very important to find out what your weak link is so that you can work it. Because it doesn't matter how much upper body strength I do and how strong I get. If my glutes go first, I can't utilize my upper body strength. Because without my glutes, my arms aren't strong enough to do the work on their own. So that was really useful information. Anyway, I worked my way up into about 11th or 12th place. And was reeling in another guy in front of me when I heard some clickety-click behind me with some pretty good tempo. I'm like, ooh, somebody's coming hard. And all of a sudden, Julia Kern pulled up next to me. U.S. ski team, one of the best sprinters in the world, bronze medalist at the World Championships last year. She might have won a medal at the Olympics as well. Anyway, Julia's a beast. And she went by me doing a Simon-Kruger V2, and it was awesome to watch, especially at that late stage in the race, how much power she still had. That was incredible. Anyway, there were three guys that she had picked up and she was dragging them up the hill. The women started behind us, so our wave went off and then the women went off, so she caught up to the men's wave and then was dragging three of the guys that I had passed. She was pulling them in a train behind her, so I tried to hop on that train, but my glutes were just done. So I couldn't hold on long, and they got away from me. Again, it was probably with half a mile to go. So I went from 11th or 12th place back into 15th, where I stayed at the finish line, which is pretty good. And one of the kids that I finished right behind, he got 14th. He's one of the best kids at the local ski club. He's a really, really talented skier. So to be right on his butt is a good indicator of where I'm at. Awesome result, and yet part of me is disappointed that I didn't go out of the start quickly with the leaders and try to hold on to them as long as I could. My identity is like, you could have stayed with them, but in reality, my glutes would have given out quicker had I been skiing faster. But my identity just doesn't understand human physiology. It's like, no, you could have stayed with them. You should have. Next time, start faster and go with them. And it's like, yeah, next time I'll die faster. So this was the smart race strategy. Anyway, back to the drawing board, work on some glutes. Got to get the slide board out. I've been avoiding it, but that's the ticket. So we'll see if I can, I'm going to create some gentle steps towards the slide board. All right, I'm off. Probably going to drive for 30 minutes and then stop in Keene or Keene Valley and do a run up a mountain there. Probably Giant Mountain is my guess. I really like that one. And it's a beautiful view from the summit. All right.
I decided to do a run on Giant Mountain in Keene post-race, and I just tripped. Oh my God, and I smashed my shin bone like I've never smashed it before. Oh my God. Oh God, I hope it's not broken. Oh crap. Oh well, okay. Gentleness. Gentleness. Don't freak out. Calm. It's okay. It's okay. It's okay. We're going to limp back down. Oh, God. Oh, that's swollen. Okay, I can put a little weight on it. All right, I guess why did I turn the camera on? Not to tell you that I'm injured again, but because my brain so quickly wanted to go into catastrophe mode, like, uh-oh, I'm, well, probably only 3/4 of the mile from the car. I just started. But how quickly a great day turns into the worst day ever. And I immediately thought I broke my leg because I hit a really sharp rock and my whole body weight went down on it. But it's okay. Whatever happens, if it's just a really bad bone bruise, my God, that swelling is ugly. So, gentleness, it's okay. Be here. Be in the woods for a moment. The worst part is over. The shock and the initial pain and the fear, that's over. It still hurts, but it's okay. I'm used to it now. Just be present and be gentle and, well, if I have to take time off, I have to take time off. That's just the way it is. I'm just getting home from the race and I'm noticing how raspy I am. I think I did a number on my throat in the race, high volume of breathing. Stopped on the way home to get a lawnmower, electric lawnmower to replace the one that we have. And my leg hurt for about 2 hours on the drive, and maybe in the last 40 minutes, it's stopped hurting. So I'm gonna go ice it now, but it may not be as bad as it felt initially. I'm sure the bone is bruised and there's a big contusion there, but maybe a couple gentle days and then I can get back at it. We'll see. Anyway, I was listening to Dan Ariely's new book, Misbelief, on the way home. And it's interesting because he's part of a, I don't know, scandal, I guess you'd call it. A lot of his studies have been discredited. He's been accused of falsifying information, of quoting sources that don't exist, saying that he worked with certain other researchers who said they've never worked on this study. And he shrugs it all off. No, I don't know if that's true, but his new book is about misbelief, and he doesn't mention any of this in the book. I'd love to reach out to him and ask him some questions. All right. Gotta go inside, ice, unpack, unload the mower, and eat supper.
I was gonna take it easy tonight, but the leg has me a bit concerned, so I came to the studio to do some work and feel productive, take my mind off it. It's now feeling numb below the point of impact, similar to how my thumb felt when I broke it roller skiing last year. So we shall see. Gonna be nice and gentle and keep myself busy, because an idle mind is the devil's workshop. I don't want to have too many thoughts about what is to come. I'm just going to take it as it happens. On a positive note, tomorrow, Jesse Diggins, Olympic gold medalist, world champion, Julia Kern, who won today's race, Ben Ogden, who is the World Cup under 23 champion, and many other members of the Stratton Mountain School T2 elite team. They're coming to Bennington to give a talk and have a Q&A at the Memory Clinic, which is an Alzheimer's research center here in Bennington. So they're going to be here tomorrow night, and hopefully I get to film it and ask them some questions, and that's exciting. So I'll show you my week of strength training, and this week of training was a taper week, almost 12 hours. I was going to up the volume significantly next week, but I don't know what the leg will allow, so I might have to put my focus on strength training, do a lot more pulling machine. We'll see though, I don't want to put any pressure on myself, but here's what I did. I'm really getting into the deep push-ups on the ab crunch, more deep push-ups, knees to bar, some easy pulling. 1 minute sets at a pretty heavy weight on the pulling machine. Weighted pull-ups, 20-pound weight vest, weighted dips. Rest on Thursday. Super easy pulling on Friday. Yesterday I took off. And then today was the race